a couple of things you need to know. Like, if you're looking at an x-ray, you need to know what forms the two heart borders. The left heart border is formed by the left atrium. The right heart border is formed by the right atrium. So if you've got an enlargement over here in your heart shadow on the right, you need to know that that's right atrial enlargement.
Is it left ventricle or left atrium?
It's the right atrium on the right, the left ventricle on the left. And see, let me show you something right here. You see that artery coming down right there in that dotted line? That dotted line is the division between the right and left ventricles. There's actually a groove there, or sulcus. It's called the interventricular sulcus. So the sulcus is not perfectly lateral. It's more on the anterior surface of the heart. So if I'm looking at the anterior surface of the heart, I'm looking at the right ventricle right here, but over on this side is the left ventricle. That forms the left heart border. You'll see it today in lab. And in the sulcus, that's where you'll find the artery. I'll go over the artery in just a minute. Now there's also a depression where the atrium and ventricles are, and that's called the coronary groove. That coronary groove extends in the front, and it extends in the back as well. And before I forget it, let me just tell you that the atria, the right and left atria, the right atrium's here, the left atrium's going to be around the back. Each atrium has this little ear-like appendage called the auricle, like your ear. There's the left auricle, and here's the right auricle right here. It's a little, it's hollow, but it doesn't really contribute to the volume of blood being forced into the ventricle so much during atrial contraction. This is the apex of the heart. This is the base up here where the great vessels are. So if I say you're having an apical myocardial infarction, then that means that you have a blocked artery somewhere infecting the tip of the heart here, which is the left ventricle. And this Frank Netter drawing here, illustration, shows the circulation through the heart. And basically, we've got the inferior vena cava and the superior vena cava draining into the right atrium. There is a valve to the inferior vena cava to prevent blood flowing back downward during diastole. That's obvious. You don't have a valve in the superior vena cava because gravity is pulling the blood down. That's why when you stand on your head, it feels like your head's going to explode because blood can go up. It just can't go back down. The blood goes out of the right atrium through the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle, out through the pulmonary valve, through the pulmonary trunk, into the right and left pulmonary arteries, through the lungs, back through the four, two on each side, pulmonary veins, into the left atrium, through the mitral valve or bicuspid valve, into the left ventricle, out through the aortic valve to the rest of the body. That's circulation. The arteries of the heart look like this. They're the first two branches off, as I said, of the ascending aorta are the right and left coronary arteries. The right coronary artery is the front, is in front. So if you want to find the right coronary artery, it's dead in the front. The left coronary artery is all the way around the back of the aorta. It comes out of the posterior aspect of the aorta. They travel in the coronary groove and the interventricular sulcus. And the main coronary arteries are, if we look at the right coronary artery, there's going to be this nodal branch here, what we call the nodal artery. It supplies the SA node, which is the pacemaker of the heart, and I'll talk about it later. It continues inferiorly and gives off the right marginal. This supplies the inferior surface of the heart. Then flips around to the back side of the heart. Let's leave it right there for a second. The left coronary divides into the circumflex and the LAD. That little piece from the aorta to the bifurcation, that's the left coronary. It's only that long before it bifurcates. The LAD travels in the anterior interventricular sulcus all the way to the apex and then flips around into the posterior interventricular sulcus. The circumflex goes up and over and gets on the posterior aspect of the heart, and these three back here will meet up as the posterior interventricular artery. Now, that's very stylized. There usually is not a connection between the right and left coronary back here. The posterior will either be formed by the continuation of the LAD or by the circumflex. In that case, you are left coronary artery dominant. Or it will be formed by the right coronary, in which case you are right coronary artery dominant. And obviously, when you go to work for a CT surgeon, you're going to do an angiogram before you do bypass surgery, because you got to know that. There are other branches, there are many other branches. You don't need to, there's one more that is easy to find in lab, but the rest of the branches don't need to worry about them. Okay? Now, you can look at an EKG and tell if the person is having a heart attack. You can tell by these deflections, and you're going to learn this, what artery is blocked. If it's the LAD blocked, you're going to lose the anterior septal or lateral heart tissue. The septum meaning the interventricular septum is supplied primarily by the LAD. So you don't need to write this down, but if I have ST elevation, which is signifying ischemia or infarction, you'll get into that later on. If you have ST changes, you know, the PQRST, if you have ST changes and leads V456, that tells you you're having a lateral infarct. If you have lead changes in V234, that tells you you're having an anterior infarct. I don't care. You're having an LAD problem. Most people have LAD problems. That's why it's called the widowmaker. Because when that thing blocks, you're going to lose the left side of the heart, and you rather need that. If it's the inferior infarct, that's the right marginal. So if you have ST elevations in leads 2, 3, and AVF, you're having an inferior infarct. Okay, so you can, paramedic back there, she knows all this. EMT, sorry, okay. She probably still knows that. Okay, so these, the right coronary also, by the way, will get inferior posterior. And notice that if you have a blockage of the in the nodal area up here, you're going to have a rhythm disturbance, because it's the nodal artery that supplies the SA node. If you have a problem with the SA node, you're going to have a problem with the downstream AV node. Here's some examples of angiography, and you can just look at these on your own. You can see that things are blocked up pretty well right here. there's a 99% blockage, a little bit getting through, but 99% blockage, that needs a stent. So a stent is they'll take and go up through your groin, all the way back up into your coronary artery, and put that little wire mesh in there that when they release it, it expands and reinflates the artery. Somewhere over here, you can see where the stent was put in and reestablish the circulation. That's what you're doing in angioplasty. The one other branch that you'll probably see in the, down in the lab, you've got the right marginal here. There's a marginal that comes off up here. It's called the diagonal artery. And it's usually pretty large. So you'll be able to see the LAD and the diagonal and the circumflex up on the top part of the heart. The venous drainage from the heart, spectacular, very complex names here. The great cardiac vein is on the anterior surface. The middle cardiac vein drains the posterior surface. And the small cardiac vein drains the inferior surface. The great, middle, and small drain into this vein, or coalesce into this vein, called the coronary sinus. The coronary sinus. The coronary sinus drains directly into the right atrium. And you also have these small cardiac veins here, the anterior cardiac veins, that drain directly into the right atrium. You won't be able to find those, at least the opening into the atrium, but you will be able to find the opening of the coronary sinus into the right atrium. If we look into the right atrium, these are the different pieces and parts. And what you'll do in the section today is make a window like this in the right atrium. You will not be able to find the SA or the AV nodes, but you will be able to find the pectinate muscles. The crista terminalis is just the line between the rough or the rugated part and the smooth part of the atria. You'll be able to find the opening of the superior vena cava, the inferior vena cava with its valve, and right beside the inferior vena cava, you'll find the opening of the coronary sinus and its valve. And it has a valve because during atrial contraction, you don't want blood going back up into the coronary sinus. There's also a depression, an oval-shaped depression that's about the size of a nickel, a dime to a nickel, that's between the right-left atria. In you, that's called the fossa ovalis. But back when you were a little fetus, that was a hole known as the foramen ovalis. That was another place where you had a right-to-left shunt of blood. The first right-to-left shunt was at the patent ductus arteriosus, at the ductus arteriosus. The second right-to-left shunt is the foramen ovale. You don't need blood going into the right ventricle into the lungs. Send it straight over to the left side of the heart. Okay? But as soon as they clamp the cord, the pressure changes, causes that thing to close off. If it persists, that's called an atrial septal defect. And ASDs occur there. Then, of course, you have the opening in through the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle. If we go into the right ventricle, you'll make a window in the right ventricle. These are the pieces and parts. There's the septum there. So the left ventricle is over here. I wouldn't waste time cutting into the left ventricle because it's so much thicker. You're not going to see much. It's impressively thick. Do it if you want, but you don't have to. But within the right ventricle here, you're going to see the cusp of the tricuspid valve. And off of the end of the cusp, you can see up from this side, these little parachute cords. Those little parachute cords are called chordae tendinae. And they attach to these little protruding papules of muscle called papillary muscles. There are three of them for the three cusps in the right ventricle. There are two of them for the two cusps in the left ventricle. You don't need to be able to identify them, other than to say, that's a papillary muscle. On the outside of the right ventricle, you're going to see that the muscle out here is rugated as well, like that you saw here. The rugated area in the ventricle is called the trabeculae carnae. It sounds like something you eat. Trabeculae carnae. You'll see it. It's obvious. There's one other little thing in this right ventricle you'll need to find on something. Connecting the anterior papillary muscle to the septum is this band of tissue. It is about the size, it can be about the size, about half the size of a number two pencil. It's just a little band of tissue. That's called the moderator band, also called the septomarginal trabeculae. Right there. That holds a little bit of importance I'll talk about later. But you should be able to find it. Now, if we go up to the top and look down the base of the heart from above, we're going to see the aorta and the pulmonary arteries here. The two valves of the aorta and the pulmonary artery each have three cusps. So the aortic valve is three cusps, the pulmonary valve is three cusps. So if I have three cusps, like that, I got a hole in the middle. To prevent blood from going back through the hole, I'm going to put this little nodule right here in the middle of the cusp. And that closes the freaking hole. Is that not brilliant or what? There you go, right there. It closes the hole in the middle, the nodule. Supporting the valves and really located between the atria and ventricles. If you lined up the four valves side by side, they would be, so you've got the tricuspid and the mitral right there. You've got the aortic and the pulmonary right there. They're kind of on the same plane. And so supporting these valves, supporting the cusp, is this fibrous skeleton. So you have the atria on top and the ventricles below, like that. So the fibrous skeleton supports the valves, and it actually electrically isolates the atria from the ventricles. It electrically isolates the atria from the ventricles. This is important when you're talking about the intrinsic conduction pathway of the heart. The pacemaker of the heart normally is the SA node, the sinoatrial node, which is located, if you go back to that picture of the atria, right there at the, up here at the base of the superior vena cava. The AV node is down here by the tricuspid valve. So, the SA node, if you took out an SA node and put it in a dish, it would sit there and contract about 60 times a minute by itself. The intrinsic automaticity is what that's called. It just sits there and beats by itself 60 times a minute. And the thing about So 60,000 men, boom, 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 boom. The impulse from the SA node will spread out through the atria and make its way to the AB node. So once it hits the AB node, it will stimulate the AB node. Now the AB node is up there in the atria. You saw that picture. I said that the atria is electrically isolated from the ventricles. So the way you get the impulse from the atria into the ventricles is through the bundle of His. The bundle of His carries the impulse through the fibrous skeleton. And then, if it dumped the impulse out into the ventricles up at the top, and the ventricles, the wave of depolarization, or the wave of contraction was at the top, it'd be squishing blood down to the apex. There's no opening down there. You want the wave of impulse to start at the bottom. So the bundle of His, carrying that impulse, will divide into a right and left bundle branch. The left bundle branch divides into an anterior and posterior hemibranch. And then the right goes down through the septomarginal trabeculae, or the moderator band, down here at the apex of the heart. At the ends of these three branches, they end in little things called Purkinje fibers. That's where the impulse is released into the myocardium. And so the wave of depolarization starts at the apex and drives the blood up to the base, or out the aorta and the pulmonary artery. Okay? Any questions about any of that? You really need to know this circuitry here, because within a month from now, or 6 weeks from now, you're going to be learning how to read EKGs. And it's a very complex and difficult course that you're going to have to learn a new language in a few weeks. So getting a handle on this, because when you look at an EKG, you can tell where that myocardial infarction is occurring, and you can tell which bundle branch is blocked. You can tell the arrhythmia, the abnormal rhythm that's coming out of the SA or AV node. You got to know this crap. Okay? So let's talk about something real quick, and we're going to talk about this more tomorrow. But I'm throwing it out here today. Understand that you got two types of heart failure. Right heart failure and left heart failure. And heart failure just means, as I mentioned the other day, the cardiac output is not sufficient to do what it's supposed to be doing. Right heart failure means that you're not getting blood out of the right ventricle into the lungs appropriately. So if the right ventricle is backing up with blood, the backup is eventually going to go up into the right atrium. What drains into the right atrium? The superior vena cava, the inferior vena cava. They're going to get backed up. What drains into the superior vena cava? The jugular veins. Distended external jugular veins is a sign of right heart failure. JVD is what it's called, jugular venous distension. Also, if you've got JVD going on up, you're also going to have a backup into the inferior vena cava, correct? Which is going to drive fluid from the veins into the extravascular space, and you're going to wind up with dependent edema. And the edema, the dependent edema, the ankle swelling down here, due to right heart failure is called pitting edema. So when you put your finger on it and release your finger, there remains a pit. Left heart failure means that you're not getting blood out the aorta. So blood is going to back up in the left atrium, and it's going to back up in the lungs. Congestive heart failure, if it involves the left side, is going to produce symptoms of, well, they're drowning. And I'll go tomorrow how fluid shifts in the lungs because of this. But what happens is your lungs start filling up with fluid. The alveoli start filling up with fluid. And they have shortness of breath, SOB. And because the heart is continuing to try to make up for that failure, it tries to beat harder and harder. But in doing so, all it's doing is making itself hypertrophied. And so, what forms this heart border? The left ventricle. So you get this huge dilated heart shadow. So, this term cor pulmonal is what you're going to see. This is a term used to express pulmonary problems as a result of left heart failure. The pathology here is the left heart, but you can't breathe. That's cor pulmonal. Now, when you're looking at a chest x-ray and you're trying to determine, does this person have cardiomegaly, an enlarged heart? This is the way you tell. What you do is you take your fingers like that on the x-ray, and you put one finger on the left heart border, one finger on the right heart border. I can't make my hands move. I'll make it so I can reach across there. Like that. Okay? Then you take your thumb and you put it in the middle of the vertebra. And do your thumb like that, and do your little finger like that. If the little finger falls inside of the chest wall, that's a normal size heart. In cardiomegaly, your finger is going to fall outside. That's cardiomegaly. You understand what I mean? Mm-hmm. If I could get up there, I could. So if I put my finger, you know, I'm not going to break a hip trying. Oh, there's actually the confusion here. Right here. Oh, no. All right, so you know what I mean. Yeah. Everybody, you know what I mean? It's probably on a YouTube somewhere. You can. So, okay.
So, even though the heart is enlarged, your finger is going to lie outside.
Yeah, if it's enlarged, now, normally your finger's only going to be about this wide. So, when I put this thumb in the middle of my vertebral shadow, my little finger is going to be inside my chest wall. But in cardiomegaly, it's like this. So when I put it here and like that, the little finger falls outside the boundaries of the ribs. I can probably find an x-ray upstairs to show you that. Okay, so even though the heart valves are lined up like that. They're actually not lined up like that. They're more lined up like that. But it doesn't matter. You don't listen to them best there. Heart sounds, when you listen to a heart, you hear thump, 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 thump. The thump is the closure of the valves. So two of the valves close during the end of diastole, two of the valves close at the end of systole. So you're going to learn which ones do which in physiology and stuff, but that's what you're hearing. You're hearing the closure of the valves. Now, if I take a tube and I have something making noise on this end of the tube, and it's a fluid-filled tube, right? I don't hear that closure best right here. I hear the closure best down here at the end of the tube where the sound gets transmitted down the tube. So what you want to do is you want to line your stethoscope up as best you can so you can hear the aortic valve as the aortic project to that point in space. That point in space on your chest wall is the second intercostal space on the right-hand side. Remember I said the aorta comes up like this. That's where you want to hear it, up here. The pulmonic valve is the left second intercostal space. The tricuspid valve is down here around the bottom of the sternum. It's just not, there's not a really a set place. Down at the bottom of the sternum. And the mitral valve is heard best in the fifth intercostal space on the left side at the midclavicular line. Now, heart murmurs are usually caused by defective valves. They don't open right or they don't close right. And they produce an abnormal sound that you're going to hear eventually. So the best place, if you have an aortic stenosis or an aortic regurge, the best place to hear it is the right second intercostal space, just beside the sternum. That's the best place to examine the aortic valve. Okay, so if you hear a heart murmur, where does it sound the loudest? And that will give you an idea of what valve the problem is. Okay? You're okay with that? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Autonomics to the heart. These are easy. Sammy, slow down, girl. All right, so that...
just laughing because you looked at me.
Well, so autonomics to... It was the eyeball rolling up in the head. autonomics to the heart, very easy. Very easy. The sympathetics are going to speed it up. The parasympathetics are going to slow it down. Ta-da, we're done. Okay? Sympathomimetics, as I mentioned earlier, the drugs that mimic the sympathetic nerves. For those of you on Adderall for your ADHD, that's what you're doing. For those of you that are meth addicts, that's what you're doing. You're mimicking the sympathetics. Okay? Dopamine, epinephrine, Red Bulls, Sudafed, all of that stuff mimics sympathetics. Sympatholytics, I mentioned yesterday, would be like a beta blocker, which is not what you want to take if you have
asthma.
A parasympathomimetic is one that stimulates the vagus. So if I have a person coming in with a very fast heartbeat, and you're going to learn about a condition called SVT. It's called... You don't need to write all this stuff down. What I want you to do is I want you to understand what I'm telling you. So I want you to write down what it takes to understand what I tell you. supraventricular. That means it occurs above the fibrous skeleton. Supraventricular. Ventricular means it's affecting the ventricles. Tachycardia means accelerated rate. So that means there's a ventricular tachycardia, there's an accelerated rate caused by something going on above the ventricles. SVT. This is a very common thing that's going to walk into the emergency room. It occurs in young people, it occurs in old people. Most of the time it's old people. One of the ways to get somebody out of SVT, and this is an accelerated heart rate, 150, they have, if the faster the heart beats, the less time for end-diastolic filling. As end-diastolic filling goes down, cardiac output goes down. As cardiac output goes down, blood pressure goes down, you're going to get dizzy, right? You're going to feel like your heart's racing in your chest. You're getting anxious, okay? So all you gotta do is slow the heart down. We gotta convert you back to a normal sinus SA, normal sinus rhythm. So what we wanna do is we wanna shut down things and just convert you to a sinus rhythm. So one way we can do that, let's stimulate the vagus. Let's slow the heart rate. What does it say? Slows the heart rate. Okay, how do we know, right now, you already know, how can you stimulate the vagus? How can you stimulate the vagus?
Yeah, there's an area that you can...
Right, I showed you a picture. The vagus and the ninth nerve, 9th and 10, they innervate receptors here. Vagal stimulation, you can rub the carotid here and stimulate the vagus. And it can reflexively slow the heart down. Now, you don't ever want to do that anymore because people have atherosclerosis. And as you go pushing on this atherosclerotic plaque, remember that endarterectomy I told you about, all that plaque breaks through? You don't want to stroke people out. You came in and had PT and I killed you with a stroke. That's not a good way to go. So, but carotid massage is what it was known as. What other way that I told you you can stimulate the vagus? How do you test the vagus? The gag reflex. That's exactly how I treat SVT in the emergency room. I give them a tongue blade and I have them gag themselves. The sensory limb is the ninth nerve. The actual motor is the tenth. So I have them gag themselves 5 or 6 times. I mean, do a good chicken dance, you know. I don't gag them, I let them gag them. That'll stimulate the vagus. It can slow their heart down. There are other things you can do. You can push on their orbits. I don't know why that works, but you can push on their orbit, their globes, with their eyes shut, push on their globes. You can have them bear down. Go. That's called the Valsalva maneuver. Have you heard of that? Valsalva? Everybody knows that? You need to know that maneuver, Valsalva. It's not like Val Kilmer, it's Valsalva. That means increasing infraglottic pressure with a closed glottic, like you're having a bowel movement. And that's what you tell people. Bear down like you're having a bowel movement. Okay? You can do that. You can have a cough. You can actually throw ice water in their face. Up in the northern climates, you know, the little kids that fall through the ice in the ponds, they can be submerged for an hour. They come back, they warm them up, and they're perfect. There's like nothing ever happened. They were underwater for an hour. How did you survive? Well, back when you were evolutionary thing swimming in the ocean and you could dive down to 35,000 feet, you had to slow your heart rate and stuff to do that. That's called the mammalian diving reflex. So that's what happens. You throw ice water in their face and it reflexively will slow the heart. It works best in little kids. You put an ice in infants. If an infant comes in SVT, you put an ice pack on their glabella and a rectal thermometer up their butt, and it will convert them. And finally, that's the other way you can do it, is you can do a rectal exam, stimulate the parasympathetics back here in your butthole, and that will reflexively slow your heartbeat. Although I don't know, yeah. I've never done that. You know, if like a 90-year-old woman comes in and has BT, I've never said, hey. So, I don't know who the first person that did that was. It was probably the same person who ate the first raw oyster. Why would you even think of that? You know, oh, you're going to have to eat. I bet if I stuck my finger in your butt. So, I would think it would speed it up. I don't know. Maybe after it's been in there 3 or 4 weeks.